Hi, I'm Liz Homer. I'm the curator of the Turner Dodge House. And welcome to our Meet Your City program. This is a program which we have at the Turner Dodge House on the first Monday of every month at 7 o'clock, except for holidays. We sponsor a local history guru, as we like to call them, someone who has a special interest in a certain aspect of Lansing's local history. We do kind of an amateur videotaping of the program so that you can get to watch it. And we'd like to invite you to come on the first Monday at 7 o'clock to hear the program yourself and then afterwards to have a tour of the house. And now I'd like to introduce Craig Wotring, who will be talking about Lansing aviation history.
I'd like to introduce you to Lansing aviation history. I'm going to take you from the time period of about 1875 into the 1930s. We're going to talk about Professor Donaldson, who ejected part of his ballast in his balloon. We're going to talk about the early aviators that came here, the early birds as they're known, who flew in those contraptions similar to the Wright brothers. Then we're going to move into the 1920s and as Lansing prepares to dedicate the Capital City Airport. And at the same time, Lansing takes hold of having airmail delivery to this city, including one of the major manufacturing facilities, the Rio Motor Plant here. Set a world record at that time in 1928. Then we're going to go into a little further into history into the 1930s and talk about some of those aviators that came through Lansing or that were actually based here in the town. So with that, I'd like to get the slides started and go from there. If God had intended man to fly, he would have given him wings. Many still repeat this very familiar quote each time they think of going up in one of those air contraptions. That's when you see the indentations in the arms of the seats when you get on the plane. But since the earliest times, both men and women have dared to reach out into the sky with balloons, gliders, flying machines, built with bamboo, baling wire and canvas, and still today with machines that pierce the atmosphere of our world. In order to place Lansing aviation in proper historical perspective, we must take a look at its beginnings. The first recorded encounter with aviation occurred on July 3, 1875, when P.T. Barnum's Great Roman Hippodrome was performing in Lansing. One of the featured attractions was the airship P.T. Barnum, piloted by the well-known aeronaut Professor Washington Harrison Donaldson. Most balloonists in those days were referred to as professors. The Lansing Republican of July 6, 1875 recalled that the balloon ascension took place at 4:30 in the afternoon. Several thousand people had followed the balloon from Washington Avenue and 14,000 came pouring out of the tent. Professor Donaldson was the only one to make the occasion as the wind blew in fitful gusts and it was said that it was a little risky. But once the balloon was relieved of its ballast, it bounded away from Earth as if endued with life. Imagine for a moment the wonder and excitement of Lansing residents viewing this spectacular sight. But the story of Professor Donaldson has a tragic ending. 12 days later, after being in Lansing, Professor Donaldson was in Chicago to drum up more publicity for P.T. Barnum's Roman Hippodrome. Donaldson allowed a newspaper reporter by the name of Newton S. Grimwood on one of the trips. That would be Grimwood's final trip. As the balloon rose slowly that afternoon, a breeze caused the balloon to drift to the northeast over Lake Michigan. Newspaper accounts state that the lake was rough and that the balloon was unable to keep aloft. One report stated that a schooner observed a balloon very close to the surface of the lake and all at once unexpectedly gained altitude. It was believed that Donaldson lightened his load due to weather conditions by throwing Grimwood into the lake as his body was later discovered on the opposite shore of Lake Michigan. Donaldson was later found to be in Canada. Wonder why? No doubt the publication of this tragic event had an impression for Lansing residents. Powered flight did not arrive in Lansing until 1911 with the early birds. The front page of the October 11th, 1911 issue of the State Journal proclaimed, "Jimmy Ward, slated to give exhibition flights in the city. Famous Birdman is scheduled to fly under the auspices of the State Journal at the racetrack Sunday, October 15th, 1911. Says he will come if alive. He uses the fastest aeroplane in the world." And what you see here is actually a photograph of an early plane at the Lansing racetrack. The journal went on to describe the upcoming historic event in great detail. Now, I mentioned is if he's alive, here is an airplane crash of one of the early birds. Not a whole lot left of the plane. Okay? This is an Art Smith crash. Ward had just recently won the world speed record with his Curtis-built biplane at the International Aviation Meet in Chicago. An advertisement in the same issue stated, "Bring the children. Besides the novelty and thrilling interest of the exhibition, the benefit of seeing the feat of actually flying in a heavier-than-air machine will be more instructive and mean more to them than all of the explanations to be read in books." This is a rare opportunity to see a flying machine actually soaring through the air. And there's a picture of Jimmy Ward. The day following the exhibition, the journal reported Lansing's first aeroplane exhibition, which Jimmy Ward gave in his Curtis biplane Sunday afternoon, was a great success. Better than 20,000 people assembled at or near the racetrack. There's Jimmy Ward in flight. I understand in 2003 they're going to recreate the Wright Brothers flight. Any takers? October 5th, 1911 has also been recorded as the date of the first airmail to Lansing. I've actually been unable to verify this fact through primary source material, but the centennial edition of the Lansing State Journal in 1955 stated that first airmail flight in 1911 recalled that Lansing was the terminus of the first airmail flight, even though this flight was unofficial. It appears that G.E. Miller, a Detroit jeweler, popularly known as Square Deal Miller, who was a nationally known bicycle racer, engaged a pilot to fly a letter from the mayor of Detroit to the governor of Michigan, Chase Osborne, on this day. And here you see we move from one type of aircraft into another type of aircraft with the Barnstormers. During the first decade of the 20th century, aviation was strictly circus stuff, and most pilots arranged to fly postcards featuring themselves in order to increase their revenues as, quote, airmail. The first official airmail flight in Michigan took place on July 17th and 18th, 1912, in Benton Harbor. Several other pioneer flights followed. And these are examples of airmail that was carried by those pioneers. In 1913, Lansing Homecoming Week featured aviator William C. Robinson in his National Newport monoplane, one wing, the first of its kind to be seen in mid-Michigan. With his arrival, the Lansing State Journal seized the opportunity of this nationally known aviator to deliver a unique message by aeroplane. And here's a close-up of that dapper gentleman. On September 13, 1913, the State Journal reported that William C. Robinson, aviator, will drop a tube containing a copy of the State Journal addressed to Governor Ferris before the Capitol door tomorrow afternoon. It will be the first time in the history of the state that a message has ever been delivered to the chief executive by airplane. It missed its mark. Okay. One of the local theaters offered a reward of tickets to the theater and a $5 gold coin for anyone finding the tube. To my knowledge and the research I've been unable to locate whether anyone found it. This flight, as with the one rumored of 1911, were both of the unofficial nature. Now here's a different kind of aviator. This is the human fly, Mr. Gardner. He decided to take a walk up the Capitol. And there he is, perched high atop the Capitol with the American flag during 1917. At this time, we now fast forward 15 years to what I refer to as the beginning of Lansing aviation stabilization. This is a 1925 letter promoting the benefits of airmail. On January 1st, 1926, the State Journal reported that the Chamber of Commerce plans an aviation drive This drive was an effort to make Lansing an aviation center. Chamber of Commerce Secretary Charles Davis stated that an aviation division is planned up to control and advise the work and to supervise the municipal field. On January 7, 1926, Lansing residents were notified through the journal that airmail was soon to be seen for the city with the expansion of government airmail service and the issuance of the first contract airmail route held by Henry Ford to begin February 1st. But it would be at least 2 years before Lansing would actually see airmail service. This is the Civil Aeronautics Bill, 1926. In the meantime, Lansing continued to rally for the possibility of airmail. Charles Lindbergh toured the country, telling of the benefits of aviation. On August 11, 1927, Charles Lindbergh persuaded Henry Ford to take his first airplane ride. The following day, Colonel Lindbergh circled over the Lansing Capitol several times before continuing his flight in the spirit of St. Louis towards Grand Rapids. First word of a proposed airmail service for Lansing came on January 1, 1928, 2 years it took, 2 years later. Through United Airways Incorporated out of Detroit came reports that Lansing would be one of several cities in the state that would be placed on an airmail route. The following day, however, Lansing found out that they weren't going to be on the route. And a few days later found they were going to be back on the route, and then found they weren't going to be back on the route. On January 4th, the journal finally reported the local businessmen back any plan to get airmail. F.E. Mills, president of the Mills Dry Goods Company, stated that if we could get airmail from Lansing to the east, and the ladies will like this, direct to New York, Lansing women could wear clothes just 6 days after they are turned out of the style shops in Paris. He added, time is a tremendous factor in the women's clothing business. To be able to sell clothes a few days out of Paris in this part of the state would be an advantage hard to overcome if we didn't have it in Lansing. What you see here is a picture of the airport hangar, 1928, the Capital City Airport. With the beacon tower there, you see a couple of planes. The on-again, off-again reports continued for several days, and finally Charles Davis went to Washington for a conference with postal authorities. Following the conference, Davis was assured that when airmail service was arranged for Michigan, Lansing would be on the route. Finally, on February 29th, an announcement was made from Washington that Lansing was indeed to be on the airmail route. Following this announcement, the government advertised for bids for carrying the airmail, and on April 30th, awarded the contract to the Cleveland-based Thompson Aeronautical Corporation, or TAC. On June 8th, the Thompson Aeronautical Company announced that airmail service for Michigan would start July 17th. On July 5th, R.C. Tex Marshall, vice president of TAC, along with the assistant traffic manager of the company, landed at the Lansing Airport in a Stinson Detroiter plane and were greeted by several civic leaders, including Mayor Troyer. During this time, final preparations were being made by aviation enthusiasts in the city for a dedication of the Capital City Airport. During the summer, the airport was equipped with border approach and danger lights, a large beacon visible to planes for miles from Lansing, and two powerful floodlights. The original dedication of the airport had been planned for June, but weather conditions caused it to be delayed until July 14th and 15th, just a few days prior to the beginning of airmail service. On Monday, July 16th, the journal reported 70,000 helped to open the airport. During the two-day event, several contests were held, including a dead stick landing contest, Pony Express race for planes, and parachute drops. Six Army pursuit planes from Selfridge Field were among the larger attractions. What you have here are the original invoices for some of the items that took place during that weekend when they opened the airport. The blue receipt there is for 60 gallons of gas for those U.S. Army planes, which is also detailed in the lower invoice. The Hotel Olds invoice covers some of the room charges, and down at the very bottom of it, you can't see it on the screen, but it also allowed for one keg of ale. Can't imagine what that would have been. With dedication ceremonies behind them, Lansing leaders and residents turned their attention to the beginning of airmail service. Artists for the State Journal prepared a drawing for a special cachet, a design that would be placed on the first airmail letters to leave Lansing. The artwork was turned over to C.W. Otto, the new secretary of the Chamber of Commerce. For several days prior to the first flight, C.W. Otto was kept busy affixing the cachet to letters brought to his office. The post office also affixed a special government cachet to all airmail letters on the first day. And you can see here the bundles of letters that they're going ahead and affixing. Now who's this guy in the nice bow tie? History was made for Lansing on the morning of July 17, 1928, when the first airmail plane arrived at the capital city airport at 10:43 in the morning, bringing mail to the city by air. C.V. Charlie Pickup, pilot for the Thompson Aeronautical Corporation, guided the big ship into Lansing. The mail ship, christened the Miss Bay City, was described by journal reporters as a graceful blue and light yellow Stinson Detroiter monoplane with the word airmail painted on the underside of the right wing and the number 6827 on the underpart of the left wing. The plane's pilot, Charlie Pickup, was a flying sergeant in the U.S. Army starting in 1915. At that time, he was stationed in San Diego, California, shortly after this country entered the World War. At that time, he was commissioned as a lieutenant in the flying service. In 1920 to 21, he was in active air service for the federal government. His service with TAC was begun shortly before he was engaged to fly his present assignment, being Lansing's airmail. The first airmail out of Lansing was scheduled for 6:05 that evening. In the meantime, Lansing residents continued to prepare envelopes for the first flight to the tune of 32,000 dimes for postage. Airmail in 1928 was 10 cents per half ounce. Lansing Postmaster Walter Rogers reported that more than 1,000 pounds of airmail would be shipped out of the city on the first flight. Charlie Davis, former Secretary of the Chamber of Commerce, who played a leading role in the campaign for airmail in Lansing, sent out on the first flight letters to President Coolidge and Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover, among others. At the Lansing Post Office, Pilot Pickup and Postmaster Rogers labored autographing airmail presented to them by local enthusiasts. Even the governor of the state, Fred Green, was interrupted in his work to sign a small bale of letters brought in for his pen. You can see the number of autographs that are on those envelopes. Here's a letter that a local citizen had sent out on the first airmail flight. It's interesting, it says, "I'm sending this by airmail, something new for Lansing. The old town isn't what it used to be, since two flappers I knew left for California." The newspaper clipping details the departure times for airmail out of Lansing. With the departure of Lansing's first airmail shipment, the journal published an article entitled "Watching Mail Come in New Village Habit." The article stated that people of several generations ago who used to mosey down to the train station every afternoon to see the 5:15 come in will find their modern counterparts in the Lansingites, who in a short time, it is predicted, will drive out to the airport in the evening to see the 6 o'clock mail plane come in. And here Charlie Pickup signs for the airmail. Postmaster Rogers is on the right. The guys from the Thompson Aeronautical Corporation are loading up that plane in Miss Bay City on our first flight. With the assured increase in the volume of airmail carried after August 1st, when the rate is reduced to 1/4 the present figure of 10 cents per half ounce, people are going to be sufficiently interested in airmail to want to see the evening mail plane pass through on its way southwest. Those few who were on hand Tuesday evening got enough dust in their faces when the mail plane propeller started to keep them reminded of the day, until they had a chance to wash their hair anyway. They were true descendants of their grandfathers before them who used to shake cinders out of their hat brims after the engine with the wide mouth stack pulled out of the station on its way to the big city. On August 1st, 1928, the post office did indeed decrease airmail rates to 5 cents. This reduction made way for even more larger shipments. And if businesses saw that the reduction was good, but nobody realized how good at the time except for the Rio Motor Car Company locally. For several days, the Rio Motor Car Company had been preparing a promotion for the new Rio Flying Cloud to be sent by airmail across the nation. This airmail shipment was to become the largest of its kind in aviation history. 350,000 letters weighing 10 tons, requiring an armada of 18 planes. On August 21st, 1928, aviation history was indeed made in Lansing. This day was once again made a gala event at the airport, and hundreds of residents visited the airport to see the departure of the 18-plane Armada with the record cargo of airmail. The mail was transported from the post office in, of course, real trucks, which formed a long parade. Several hours were required to load the mail on the planes. Here you see a photograph of Ransom Ohls on the left, Governor Green in the center, and Postmaster Rogers on the right. The first plane of the Armada winged its way from the capital city airport at 1 o'clock, piloted by Tex Marshall of the Thompson Aeronautical Corporation. He was headed for Chicago. In Chicago, the airmail would be unloaded and dispatched onto other planes to Rio dealers in 33 states. So important was this event that several of the larger newsreel companies of the country sent cameramen here to photograph the departure of the planes. Among those present were MGM, Fox International, and Hubley, official photographer for the Rio Motor Car Company. Here you see an aerial view of the Capital City Airport, and here a close-up of the 18-plane Armada. The flight to Chicago took just over 2.5 hours, big difference from today. The first plane to return to Lansing left Chicago at 5 p.m. Eddie Preston piloted the Miss Carrie K back to Lansing carrying 4 passengers. Among those on the flight were Rio Motor Car Company representatives and a reporter for the State Journal. On August 22nd, the day after the flight, the Journal reported that moving pictures were taken of the Chicago-bound plane. These films will be shown to the public on small projection machines set in dealers' windows in Lansing. I've been unable to locate any actual film footage from this. 1928 was indeed a banner year in the history of Lansing aviation. Only a single incident closed out the year on a rather muddy note. On Tuesday, December 18, an airmail plane of TAC became mired so deeply in the mud that it required the services of men and horses and about 3 hours' labor to get it out. The mud was reported to be several inches deep, and because of that fact, TAC discontinued airmail service to Lansing for 3 days, or until the field froze sufficiently to permit planes to land again. Service was resumed on December 22nd. For several years following the first airmail flight out of Lansing, large air tours would be held in Lansing commemorating the anniversary. The events were sponsored by the Chamber of Commerce and the Junior Chamber of Commerce. And at each annual event, a special cachet was prepared for the flown mail. Also during this time, several famous aviators visited Lansing, including Wiley Post on September 11, 1933, and Amelia Earhart on October 28, 1933. On February 9, 1934, the commercial airmail contracts then in force were suspended by President Roosevelt. It was turned over to the Army, who originally flew the mail in the early days of government aviation, in the late teens, actually. The last contract airmail flight left Lansing at 6:20 in the evening on February 19th. As with many government ideas and decisions, this one proved to be ill-conceived. In less than 1 month, 12 Army airmail pilots had lost their lives while carrying the mail. On May 8, 1934, not long after, revised commercial airmail contracts were returned to private carriers. Here you have a cover that commemorates the second annual Michigan Air Tour, 1930. And if you see the violet five-line stamp there, this is transported in the Pathfinder plane, Ted Abrams, pilot, Abrams Aerial Survey Corporation, Lansing, Michigan. This was transported in this plane, this Pathfinder, and there you see a picture of Ted Abrams. On the 40th anniversary of the airmail, a nationwide airmail week celebration was held. Articles in the State Journal recalled the first flights and the progress in airmail. Special envelopes were prepared by both the Chamber of Commerce and private individuals to mark the occasion. A few of Lansing's other aviators, this photograph of Art Davis and his plane for the Michigan Airways Incorporated out of East Lansing. And if you notice the caption out at the bottom, it says R.G. Leavenworth, aerial photographer. Okay? Leavenworths are still in business today. Here's a young man, a souvenir. He rode with pilot Art Davis in the pride of East Lansing. Why don't you? and a nice little souvenir from that ride, and that's one of Art Davis's planes. Art Davis conducted many of the air circuses at the time and had his own troupe. Among the star attractions were Clem Soane, who was a well-known Batman. On a trip overseas, he did not repack his wings and his parachute, and he fell to his death. Those are actually at the Michigan Historical Museum, and they just went off display here within the last couple of months. To replace him was Charlie Zamuda, okay, as another Batman. And they would fly out as part of the air circus. Well, ladies and gentlemen, much of Lansing's aviation history and airmail history remains to be rediscovered by today's historians. Most of the history has been just a footnote in any of the history books. And there's much out there to discover. So I thank you for your time tonight, and I hope you enjoyed the presentation. Thank you.